Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, let us shout glory. Glory. What a privilege to be in the house of God. It's a pleasure to see all of you. It's a pleasure for us to be in the house of God, to worship Him in spirit and in truth. So it's just great. Amen. I'm going to do a short teaching with you. And then at the end of the service, we'll do some logistics. We'll talk a little bit. But we're going to close this year with three major nights. It's going to be 12 nights of worship and praise. But the last three nights, we're going to do them simultaneously in Creole and in English. So while we're going to have the Creole in the gymnasium, we're going to have the three nights in English here. And our goal is to pack this place with English speakers, but especially our young people, to pack this place in worship. Hallelujah. What a great opportunity to just close that year in worship in the presence of God. Amen. So basically the 30th, the 31st, and the 1st, we're just going to pack this place three times, full with young people and giving God our best worship. Amen. So right after the service, we're going to talk about that just a little bit and get into some of those logistics very quickly. So let me go straight to a teaching that, let me just continue the teaching that we've been doing on the fear of the Lord. We began that last Sunday, and this Sunday again, I want to teach on the fear of God and look at another aspect of the fear of God, namely how to walk in the fear of God. Lord, we commit this time of teaching to you. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you inspire us and that you show us how to walk in the fear of you, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, last Sunday, we started talking about the fear of God. And we said that the fear of God is an inner motivation that drives you to walk in the will of God. It is an inner motivation, something inside of you that drives you to walk in the will of God. Every time you get out of the way, every time you drift away from Him, there is something that just pulls you back to the presence of God. And that something is called the fear of God. Somebody say the fear of God. Now, but one of the things that we had said as you grow in the Lord, that motivation changes. That inner drives, it changes. It still gives you the same result. But the reason why you fear God changes as you grow in your relationship with the Lord. So one of the things that we said is that when you are a baby in the faith, your fear is based on a sense of danger. When you look at the power of God, the greatness of the power of God, if God uses His power against you, it's dangerous. So the fear is based on the sense of danger. And what it brings in your life, it brings a form of distress. Distress is mental anguish. Distress is mental suffering. When somebody's in distress, you're suffering, but you're not suffering in your body. You're suffering in your mind, and it's called distress. Fear brings distress. It makes you suffer, but in your mind. When, for example, I'm about to cross, let's say somebody were to ask me to cross 95 by foot, then suddenly, I become afraid. That afraid manifests itself in the form of a distress because I start thinking and I start feeling how the car is going to hit me, how it's going to feel in my body. And it's called distress. And it's not such a bad thing as you and I would think. It's not really a bad thing. Fear based on a sense of distress, when we are able to feel a pain before, when we are able to feel pain psychologically before it manifests itself physically, it's a good thing because you have the opportunity to change your course of action so whatever you feel is going to happen doesn't really happen. The reason I don't cross 95 is because the closer I get to 95, I'm already feeling how those cars are going to hit me. As a result, I do not cross. Does that make sense? So the feeling that what I'm feeling when I'm getting, it's a form of distress. But it's a good form of distress because it keeps me away from evil. So the first aspect of fear, it's based on the sense of danger. But as you grow in God, you move to another level. The basis of fear changes. As you get to know God, when you didn't know God, all you knew was, okay, if I sin, you know, there is a punishment for sin, and God is the great judge of the universe. He's the great moral voice of the universe. He rewards good, but he also punishes the wrong. So at first, our conception of God was simply the moral judge of the universe. But as I start to grow in God, I'm like, wow, you know, he's not just a judge, but, he's a creator. He's omniscient. He's omnipotent. And I start to think of the majesty of the world and the billions and billions of stars that he created. I started studying the human body, and I started studying a cell. Now, I don't know if one of you have ever taken a biology class, but I would say take a biology class for fun. Anybody ever thought about that? You know, take a biology class for fun. But I'll tell you, when you're studying, you're studying molecular biology and you know, when you're studying, like, for example, how a cell functions and the molecule and the things in your body, but you study the anatomy of a cell, it's like an entire city. It's well organized. Inside just one cell in your body, it has its own electrical plant that gives it energy. Just one cell in your body. That cell has its own garbage collection system. It's got a cell is like functions like a city. And when you think about that, God, a cell that is way smaller than the tip of a needle, and God organizes it like a city. I mean, when you start thinking about the greatness of God, man, you're like, man, you know, that God is a great God. So now there is you have a sense of majesty, a sense of greatness. That God is not anybody. He's great. And that sense of greatness in return is going to bring admiration. When I think of the universe, when I think of the great things you created, now I have admiration for you. So when the first level of the fear of the Lord is based on the sense of danger, then it moves to a sense of admiration because of everything that the Lord has done. And then you move on. And then you move on. The last level of the fear of the Lord is when it really becomes personal, where you thank the Lord, where it is based on a sense of goodness, how good God has been to you. When you think of how good God has been to you, it breeds gratitude in your heart. And that sense of gratitude will lead you to obey him. And the reason you fear him, is not because he's going to whoop you. The reason you fear what? You fear hurting him. You fear not being faithful to him. You fear not being good to him because he's been so good to you. You fear in return that God who's been so good, so loving, so great, so merciful to me, I don't want to do anything that offends him. There is a fear. It's not based on God whooping you or danger. It's based on love. I love him too much to hurt him. Does that make sense, church? There's a fear that comes out of love. There's a fear that comes out of love. Whenever you really love somebody, there should be fear. So that's why I say, you know, some people will say, okay, I love God, I don't fear God. Then I say those people don't understand fear and they understand love. Whenever you really love somebody, whenever there is true love, fear always exists. If you really love somebody, then you fear doing things that can offend them. You fear doing things that can hurt them. You fear doing things that would not be good to them because they have been so good to you. Does that make sense, church? And the highest level of fear is the fear that is motivated by love. You heard what I said? Did you guys hear that? I'm going to say it again. The highest level of fear is the fear that is motivated by love. I'll tell you that. When I was in Haiti growing up, I used to play soccer ball. When I come back. Now, JJ, don't listen to this and don't do it. But I'm used to tell what I used to do to my dad. Don't do it to me. Just like you know. But I remember when I was in Haiti, I used to love playing soccer ball. When I come back from school, instead of doing my homework, I used to play soccer ball. And every time my dad come, he'd give me a whooping. But guess what? I would get that whooping, and then tomorrow I'd play soccer ball again. I would get that whooping, and I'd play soccer ball. And in some days, I'm playing soccer. I know I'm going to get that whooping. I know I'm going to get that battle. I enjoy the soccer ball even more because I'm like, you know, I know I'm going to get that whooping, so I might as well make it real fun. So I played it, you know. The time I knew I was going to get the whooping was the time that I had the greatest fun. I made sure I enjoyed every single moment of it because I know once I'm done, I'm getting my whooping. It didn't stop me from playing soccer ball. You see, fear based on judgment has a limit. You just heard what I said? Fear based on judgment works, but it has a limit. Whereas when later on I grew up and I understood that my dad was not a professional, my dad was not somebody who graduated from high school. He's just a very smart man who sacrifices a lot for his children. And I understand my dad would work long hours, 14 hours, 16 hours a day in order to give me a good education. Then when I understand the sacrifice he was putting in order to give me a good education, what he was never able to do with the whooping, as soon as I understood how much he loved me and how much he was investing in my life, I felt it was not fair for me to let my dad work 14 hours, 15 hours, 16 hours to pay for my school and not bring good grades at home. Does that make sense to you? It just didn't. Suddenly now I have a motivation. I'm not motivated by the whooping, but I'm motivated by a sense of gratitude. If this man took his time to invest that much in my life, the best that I can do is to bring some good grades in the house. So now I'm doing what he wants, but I'm not doing it out of a sense of danger and fear or out of a sense of danger and distress. I'm doing it out of a sense of gratitude. If that man provides everything that I need, he gives me food, he gives me clothes, and he pays for my school and work many hours in order to get that. So the best that I can do is to give my very best. Does that make sense? So that's why I told you the highest form of fear is the fear that is based on love and gratitude. When you understand what he means to you and what he's done in your life. And when you get to that point, I'll tell you, you're willing to give everything that you have. They tell, you know, in the John who wrote the epistle of John and the book of Revelation, he had a student of his called, he had a disciple called Polycarp. And around the second century, they were persecuting Christians. And you either had to choose between Christ or death. So they actually gave this guy the choice. They said, listen, you have two choices. You could either deny Christ and live, or you could say that you won't deny Christ and we'll burn you on a stick. So what do you want to do? Do you want us to look at the fire? You want us to burn you alive, or do you want to simply deny Christ and live? And the man said, listen, he said, I've been serving Christ since I was an old man. He said, I was serving Christ since I was a young man. He said, now I'm close to 100 years old. He said, he's never failed me once. He's never failed me once. He's never hurt me once. He's never been unkind to me once. How do you want me to deny him now? Since I was a young man, I've been serving this Jesus, and he's always good to me. Now I'm an old man, and you ask me to deny Jesus Christ. I'd rather die. Burn me. But I won't deny him because he's a great. Hallelujah. So Polycarp was one of what you call the martyr of the early church, people who died for the faith, for his faith in Christ. He says, this man has been good to me in my entire life. There's nothing that you're going to do to make me deny him. He's just been too good to me. When fear is based on a sense of gratitude, nothing can come against it, not even death. Nothing can quench it. Nothing can kill it. not even death. When you love, when you fear God out of love, when you fear God because he's been so great to you, and you're motivated by a sense of gratitude, there is nothing. There is no suffering that you won't take. There is not no sacrifice that you will not make. There is nothing that you will not be willing to face because he's been too great to me. He's loved me so much that whatever that I have in return can never pay for that love. And that is the highest level of fear. Does that make sense? Now, let me just share very quickly today. I want to give you some practical advice. It's good for me to talk about the fear of the Lord and to motivate you to walk in the fear of the Lord. But if I don't tell you to do what exactly you need to do, the fear of the Lord might not be a reality in your life. So I want to make sure that I tell you exactly what you need to do, or at least give you some suggestions in terms of how to walk in the fear of God. So I want to give you three things that you can do to walk in the fear of God. Number one, to walk in the fear of God, cultivate an awareness of the presence of God. Cultivate an awareness of the presence of God. Cultivate an awareness of God's presence. If you want to walk in the fear of God, the very first thing, try to be aware of his presence all around you and all day long. Why do you say that, Pastor Greg? Because most of the time, when we do something that's wrong, whenever we sin, we do something that we shouldn't have done, is because for a split second, we forgot that God is there. Does that make sense, church? Most of the time when we do something wrong, it's difficult for you to sin when you remember God is next to you. He's looking at you. His ears are open and he's listening to you. It's difficult to be aware that God is watching you, signing that paper on that computer screen, on that conversation. He's hearing you for you to say certain things that displease him. The reason we say and we do things that are displeasing to God is because we tend to forget. Not only is heaven watching, but he's right there next to us. He said, "Lo, I am with you. I am with you. I am with you." He's not just up there watching. He's next to you. Whenever we become aware of the presence of God who is around us, automatically it brings the fear of God. Does that make sense, church? Does that make sense? Whenever we are aware of the fear of God, whenever we are aware of the presence of God, automatically it brings the fear of God. Jacob said in Genesis chapter 28, Jacob left his place and he was going to Laban's house. And the Bible says on the road, he took a stone and put his head on it. And when he put the stone, the Bible said, the heavens opened and he saw a stairway. He saw a ladder. And then he saw angels ascending and descending. And he saw God at the top of that ladder speaking to him and says, "I am the God of Jacob, the God of Isaac, the Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." And he says, "I will bless you. I will be with you wherever you go." And the Bible says, in the morning, the text says, Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, "Surely the Lord is in this place." But what's the problem? The problem is that I did not know it. The problem, it's not that God is not there. He's there. It's you and I who are not aware of his presence. So it's the same thing. In your office, he's there. In your bedroom, he's there. When you're in front of the internet, he's there. When you're alone in the dark, he's there. When you're driving, wherever that you're going, he's there. The only reason why we don't realize that he's there is because it's you and I who are not aware of his presence. Now, in order for us to be aware of his presence, there are certain things that we must do. What did Jacob do to become aware of the presence of God? The Bible says while he was walking, he took the stone and put his head on the stone. When he put his head on the stone, heavens opened and he saw and he became aware of the presence of God. What does the stone represent, or who does the stone represent? The stone represents Christ. The Bible says the stone that the builders have rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Speaking of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the the stone that the world rejected, that has become the chief cornerstone of men. So the stone is an image of Jesus Christ. Once he put his head, once he put his mind, once he put his thoughts on the stone, suddenly heaven's open. The same way heaven opened for Jacob is the same way that heaven's open for you and I. God is all around you. His presence is all around you. Why don't I know he's there? Why don't I experience his presence? It's very simple, because I don't put my mind on him. At this time, my mind could be on what I'm doing. It could be on my problem. It could be on my friends. It could be on anything but God. But the moment I take a little time, wherever I am, in my room, in my office, in my house, to put my mind on that stone, to put my thoughts on Christ, suddenly I become aware of his presence. He's been there all of that time. Does that make sense, church? So one of the things that can help you to build, to walk in the presence of God and walk in the fear of God, is to put, I like to put what I call my Holy Spirit alarm. Sometimes I set it for 15 minutes. Sometimes I set it for 30 minutes. Sometimes I set it for an hour, depending on what I'm doing. But every time that hour, every time that alarm rings, I just take a few minutes, a few seconds, a few minutes to turn my thoughts to Christ. Every time that alarm rings, I just pause and think about Christ. I just pause and become aware of the presence of Jesus Christ who is next to me. Does that make sense? When you start having that habit throughout the day, where you make it a habit to pause and think about Christ, pause and put your mind on the stone, pause and put your mind on Jesus Christ, suddenly you start to have a conscious, you become conscious of the presence of God. And I'll tell you, in the beginning, when you're first doing it, you need an alarm. But I'll tell you, as that becomes a habit, because the human mind, your body, everything in you can form habits. Your body forms habits, your mind forms habits, and your spirit forms habits. As you start to train your mind like that, if you train your mind for every 15 minutes, or you train your mind for every half an hour, or you train your mind at every hour, what you're going to realize by the time you do it one day, 2 days, 7 days, 20 days, 21 days, you do it for a month, and then you're going to get to the time, every time that time comes, and your mind is going to learn to disengage from the world and move to the presence of Christ. Does that make sense? And suddenly, all around me, I am always aware of that presence. The problem is not that God is not with us. Jesus already says he's with you. Everywhere you go, Christ is always there. Does that make sense? Everywhere you go, Christ is always there. The problem is, the only reason we are not aware of the presence of Christ is because there. Why do I become aware of the presence of Christ when I come to church? Because when you come to church, you forget about the world and you focus on Christ. That's the only difference. Does that make sense? If you walk on the streets, and sometimes, some of the greatest moments that I've had in the presence of Christ, where the presence of God filled me, has not been in church. It's been walking in the street. Sometimes I get up and I walk in the street, and, when I go for my prayer walk, I walk and I sing and I praise the Lord. Some of the greatest experience of the presence of God that I've had have not been in church. So it's not about being in the church. It's not in the place, although the place is important too. But it's not primarily about the place. Wherever you are, if you learn to turn your mind to Christ, you could be in your shower, you could be in your car, you could be in the street. If you would do what Jacob did, you take your mind, your thoughts, your reflections, everything that you got, you focus your heart on Christ, immediately the presence of God will manifest. Does that make sense? So when the Bible says, James chapter 4 verse 8, and the Bible says, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. That's what the Bible says. Draw near to God, he will draw near to you. Now, that's very interesting. Pay attention to the text. Whose responsibility it is to draw near to God? Who initiates the process? When you want to become aware of the presence of God, who makes the first step? You. The Bible says, draw near to God, and the result is that he will draw near to you. So sometimes people will say, I feel that God is far away these days. It's very simple. Draw near to God. And how do you do that? Now, what do you mean draw near to God? If God is already near me, he's all around and he fills the universe, what does it mean to draw near to him? When the Bible says draw near to God, it's not something that you do. It's not something that's physical. He's not talking about space. He's talking about an attitude of the heart. What does it mean to draw near to God? To draw near to God means to shut off the world for a few minutes and for a few seconds and make the God the focus of your attention. When you do that, you draw near to Him. So how do you draw near to God? You draw near to God with your mind. That's how you do it. It's not space. It's mind. You draw near to God by forgetting everybody for a moment and remember Christ and focus on Christ and thank Christ and exalt Christ. Once you do that, you draw near to Him, and suddenly his presence becomes real to you, which means that He draws near to you. Does that make sense, church? So the first thing that we do to walk in the fear of God, and whenever Christ's presence becomes real to you, sinning becomes impossible. Sinning becomes impossible. You could be in a room, you know, think about it. You could be in a room getting ready in the last minute, to do whatever that you're going to do. It's a fornication, it's for sexual immorality. Suddenly the presence of Christ shows up. What's going to happen? You're going to lose your momentum and you're going to lose everything. You're going to lose interest. Whenever you remember the presence of Christ, there are conversations you're having, and you're using a certain language, and suddenly you remember that Christ is there. Then you retract your words, or whatever that you were going to say, you stop it because you remember that He's there. The first remedy, the first thing that conduces the presence of Christ, that makes the fear of God become real in your life, is the presence of Christ. Amen? So number one, cultivate the presence, the awareness of the presence of God. Number two, let's move rather quickly. Number two, experience godly sorrow for your sins. Now, that's very important. Experience godly sorrow for your sins. Look at what the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 9. Look at what it says. It says, now rejoice that you were not made, rejoice, not that you were, I rejoice, not that you were made sorry, but that your sorrow led to repentance. For you were made sorry in a godly manner, that you might suffer loss from in nothing. You were sorry in a godly manner. In other words, there is something that is called godly sorrow. Do you guys understand that? There is something called godly sorrow, and that process, that thing called godly sorrow, that feeling, that emotion, that sentiment, is important for your spiritual growth and spiritual development. Now, whenever you are experiencing sorrow, you're experiencing sadness, it's painful. It's emotionally painful. And some people run away from every kind of pain. But not every kind of pain should be ran away from. There are pains that you have there. It's a good thing. They prevent further danger. If I touch a hot stove, immediately I feel pain. But you know what that pain does? It tells me, take out your hand very quickly if you don't want to lose your entire arm. Isn't it true? When I touch the stove, the pain that I get is telling me, this is dangerous. Take out your hands. You're going to lose your arm. And immediately I feel that and I take it back. And that's what prevents me from losing my arm. If I didn't, I would let it on the stove and it would burn me completely. Sometimes we run away from every kind of pain, but sometimes it is through the painful situations in life that we learn important lessons that help us not to destroy ourselves later. Does that make sense? So we got to be very careful with that. So often we run. Some people run from every kind of physical pain. Some people run from every kind of emotional pain. Whenever we do something wrong and our conscience accuses us and our conscience reproaches us and our conscience corrects us. And there are some people, that inner voice, that inner sadness, they try to do everything that's possible so they don't experience it, that inner suffering. So let's say that they did something wrong, and let's say we're having a conversation and they feel that they were wrong and they're not feeling good about it. They start the conversation and then walk away in the middle of the conversation. They don't want to finish the conversation because it's painful. If they did something wrong and they start feeling the remorse, the sorrow of what they had done as a consequence of what they had done, they try to find something else to do in life. Okay, let me go and play basketball. Let me drink. Let me go and do something with my friends. Anything so I don't have to deal with the pain. The problem of not facing the pain is that it is the pain that's telling me, it is the pain that I experience that's going to prevent me from repeating that error. So when I don't go through that process and I don't want that pain, I don't want to let that pain have its course. I never really experience it because I always dodge it. I always divert it. I always go around it. And guess what? Next week, I do exactly the same thing. So there is something when we commit something that's wrong, we need to give ourselves time to experience godly sorrow. In fact, the sorrow or the grief or the sadness that you experience is not even yours. It's the grief of the Holy Spirit. When we sin, the Bible says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit. When we grieve the Holy Spirit, when we sin, the Holy Spirit inside of us is sad. And the sadness we are experiencing is not even ours. It's the sadness of the Holy Spirit every time we break the law of God. Every time we sin, every time we do something wrong, the Holy Spirit is sad inside of us, and we are experiencing that. Unfortunately, some of us don't even want to face that sadness. And as a result, what happens is these things repeat over and over. As a Christian, when we do something that's not right, we got to give time for godly sorrow. In that godly sorrow, two things happen. First of all, we feel what God feels about that sin. Does that make sense? We feel the heart of God towards that sin. We feel the heart of God towards that situation. We feel the heart of God towards what we've done. Sometimes we do it because we never really feel what God feels like. Whatever that you're feeling, it's the Holy Spirit feeling it, and He's sharing it with you so you could see it's not sweet, it's not nice, and you don't keep on redoing it. Does that make sense? So in that godly sorrow, we experience a certain level of emotional suffering and spiritual suffering. And what it does, it prevents us from doing it the next time. It alerts us so we don't put ourselves back in that same situation. Okay? The second thing that that it does in that time of godly sorrow, that time of godly sorrow is also a time of teaching. When we allow time for godly sorrow for what we have done wrong, we take a time of retreat. We take a time of fasting. Originally, that's what fasting was about. Fasting was about a time of humbling ourselves, a time of remorse for what we have done wrong. When David had sinned against Bathsheba, what he did, and the prophet announced him the condemnation, what he did, he went, the Bible says, he took his sackcloth and went before the Lord. Sometimes you need to declare your own personal fast. You don't have to wait for Tabernacle of Glory to fast. There are things that you've done. You need to have your own time of fasting, where you go before the Lord with your sackcloth and you say, Lord, my life is open before you. Show me why do I do what I do. Does that make sense? So you declare a time of fasting. In that time of fasting, Lord, I'm sorry for the way that I've lived as a believer. I want to be a better person. So you feel what God feels towards your sin, and you give God an opportunity to test you. You give God an opportunity to show you your life. You know, the Bible says something about the heart of men in Jeremiah chapter 17. The Bible says the heart of men is exceptionally deceitful. And the Bible says, ask the question, who can know it? The Bible says the heart of men is exceptionally wicked and deceitful, and who can know it? You know what that means? It means that even us, sometimes we don't know our hearts. He said the exception, and he said, who can know it? The answer is nobody knows it. And then in the next verse, it says, God knows all things. So sometimes you and I, when we sin, We need to go before the Lord. And it's not always the time when we sin. Sometimes we just need periodically to just go into a time of fasting for self-examination, even if we had not committed any particular sin. Does that make sense? And we go before the Lord. But especially when we have sinned, we come before the Lord, we experience godly sorrow, and then we ask the Lord, Lord, show me why did I do what I didn't want to do? I knew it was wrong, but why did I do it? And in that time of grieving, when you sin against the Lord, there needs to be a time of grieving. When you grieve over your sin. Is the church hearing that? Because I'll tell you, people don't talk about that these days. We simply just talk about the love of God. I sin, Lord, I ask you for forgiveness, God loves me, and then we move on. And you know what? That we never take time to reflect on our sins. We never take time to feel the heart of God towards our sins. No wonder we could keep on repeating it. Because we feel nothing and we learn nothing. We simply say, okay, you know, God is grateful and God is a God of love. And we don't feel the grief that the Holy Spirit is feeling. We never take the time to ask the Lord, you know my heart, dig deep into my life and show me the root cause of that issue. You get root cause of things when you take time to grieve over that sin. You take time of fasting and you take a few days off and be in the presence of God. Lord, I can't keep on going like this. I can't keep on committing the same sin. I can't keep on doing the same thing. So, Lord, show me where this thing is coming from. And suddenly you will see that God will show you the origin, the root of that problem. Because if you want to really take care of a sin issue in your life, you know, you got to look at the root cause. Any tree that you cut at the middle will grow again. But if you cut it, you know, at the root, it will not grow. Sometimes when we have things that are in our lives that are not right, we need to ask the Lord, what's the root of that thing? There are people who there are people who commit sexual sin and who have sexual misbehaviors, but the problem is not sex and the problem is not sexual. Sometimes people have sexual problems, but the origin is actually something emotional or something spiritual. There are people who fall in adultery and their problem is not sex. Their problem is attention. You heard what I said? Yeah. There are people who commit adultery, but the problem is not because they cannot control their sex drive. Their problem is attention. Their problem is, you know, when somebody say hi, you know, you look great, you look cute, you look whatever, and suddenly, oh, wow. Wow, I forgot I was supposed to go to the store. Suddenly, you know, I forgot where I was going. You know, it's not what he said. It's not what he said. It's how he said it. It's how. And suddenly all the defenses are down and all doors are open and I'm already available. My heart is already open and my life is already open. Why? Because that person gave me attention. The real problem in this case is not sex. The real problem is that the fact that somebody looked at me. But when I know the root of the problem, then I go to the scriptures and I start to study the word of God. Then I realize that the person who really looks at me is not that joker who said you look good. It's the God who heavens, who got guides me with my eye. It's the God of heavens who created me and said, you are fearfully and wonderfully made. You are beautiful in my eyes. I love you so much that I died for you on the cross of Calvary. And I live every day to intercede for you at the throne of the Father. Once I know that I am beautiful and I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Once I know that I got God's attention. So I wouldn't care about the attention that you either give me or that you don't give me. It doesn't make a difference because the King of the universe gives me all the attention that I want. If you give me a compliment, I'll say thank you. If you don't give it, I won't be offended. If you give it, I'll say thank you. But don't you think you will be able to manipulate me with compliments and attention and saying that you're beautiful because I am secure in the God that I am serving? Somebody say glory! He said, but you only discover these things when you take time to reflect. Lord, what did I do? Why? What I did? What's the root cause? Show me. And suddenly you're able to go to the root of things and change things and pull them out and become a better person. People who don't take time to grieve over their sins repeat them over and over and over again. because they don't learn from their mistakes. But when you do, you grow from it. You become a better person. Does that make sense? So take time to grieve over your sin. Lastly, last advice that I want to give you to walk in the fear of God. Number one was what? What was number one? Cultivate an awareness of the presence of God. Number two? Okay, experience godly sorrow for your sin. Number three, important. Develop a strong vigilance against evil. Develop a strong vigilance against evil. You see, look at what Proverbs chapter 8, verse 13 says. Proverbs chapter 8, verse 13. What does it say? Let's read together. It says, The Bible says, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil. What is the fear of the Lord? Hating evil. When you hate something, do you stay close to it?
No.
Or do you stay far away from it? If you hate something, you stay far away from it. You see, what the fear of God, what develops the fear of God is when you hate evil. And you know why a lot of us don't walk in the fear of God? Because inside of us, we lack that real hatred for evil. Hatred for evil is good hatred. You never heard of a good hatred? There is good hatred. When you hate what's wrong, it's a good hatred. The Bible says the fear of the Lord is to hate evil. Most of the time, you know how you and I behave when it comes to evil. Let's say evil is over here. And then, let me see our attitude. How close can I get to evil? That's how we do it. How close can I get to evil? I know, Pastor, we're not supposed to have sex before marriage, but how far is too far, Pastor? How far is too far? So we're not supposed to have sex before marriage, but 11:30 at night, we go by the beach, you know, and there is a nice wind blowing over us, and we're just listening to some romantic movie. I heard that we went there to have a night prayer. It's called a night watch, you know. It's called a night watch. You know, we're going to pray together. But, you know, you need to know your body, is not made of iron. It's not made of wood. It's made of flesh. And flesh have sensations. And flesh have feelings. So at 11 o'clock in the morning, you're in the dark, you're by the beach, you're listening to romantic movies hand in hand, and you tell me you're going to talk about Jesus. Just give me a break. You're not going to talk about Jesus. You're not going to talk about Jesus. You're going to find some other things to talk about. So, if you know, it's getting close to evil. If you don't want to fall in evil, what do? You stay away. You give yourself some boundaries, brother. I got some boundary with that brother, and I got some boundary with that sister. I got a time that, you know, we're going to talk about sometime, but we got distance. There's physical boundary. There are parts you can touch. There are parts you can't touch, my brother, until you put that ring in that finger. It's called boundary, baby. There are things that I'm going to talk to you about, but there are things that are not your business right now. Until you put a ring in my finger, it's not your business, brother. It's called boundaries. Does that make sense with me? It's called boundaries. You stay as far away as possible. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, is to give ourselves boundaries and stay away from certain things. And when we develop the fear of God like that, you know what the fear of God becomes? The fear of God becomes a personal alarm system. Oh my goodness. The fear of God becomes a personal alarm system. It gets installed in your heart. You install it in your heart. And you know how you install the fear of God in your heart? You install the fear of God in your heart through the Word of God. The Bible says, your word, I have hidden your word in my heart that I may not sin against you. So when you pick up your Bible every day, you wake up. Now listen, look at what it says. He didn't say, I've hidden your word in my mind. He said, I've hidden your word in my heart. You know, I love the word. I want to practice the word. I eat the word. I have an appetite for the word. I got a passion for the word. I want to live the word. I want to manifest it in my life. When you take that the word with that kind of appetite, it installs the word inside of your life, and it becomes a personal alarm system. You know what the word says that you can do, and you know what the word says that you can't do. The word that comes inside of you, when it reaches inside of your heart, that word of God becomes the fear of God, and that word becomes a personal alarm system. Every time, you see, in your home, you may have ADT, for example, installed in your home, and when you're leaving your house, you install ADT in your home, and then you put the code. And if while you were out, you had an intruder, some person entering illegally into your home, as soon as that intruder comes in, it could be a person, it could be a cat, it could be a dog, it could be whatever it is, and the sensors go off, the sensor pick it up, and the alarm goes off, and you hear something like this, it means your alarm goes off. But you see what happened? When you got the word of God installed in your heart, as soon as a thought crosses your mind that is not of God, there is something that goes off. No. You're about to touch the person in a certain way, and you're like, no. You're about to get on certain internet site, and the alarm goes off. No. You're about to sign certain papers. You're about to say certain things, and the alarm of the fear of God goes off inside of you. No. What? Suddenly, the alarm of the fear of God goes off. When you got the fear of God in your life, you got your own personal alarm system. Every time you're about to do something that will jeopardize your future, that will jeopardize your spiritual life, that will jeopardize your moral life, suddenly that alarm goes off. The fear of God is your personal alarm system. Somebody say, Lord, install your alarm system in my life. Lord, install the fear of God in my heart. Lord, install the fear of God in my life. Say it louder. Say, Lord, install the fear of God in my life, in the name of Jesus Christ. The worst thing that can ever happen to a believer, or to anybody for that matter, is to have no moral alarm, no ethical alarm, no spiritual alarm. I'm about to do something that's gonna jeopardize my entire future, but nothing goes off inside of me. That's a problem. I'm a young man, and I'm involved in income tax fraud, credit card fraud, and I'm filling out applications on other people's name, and I can get 50 years in jail for that. I can get 75 years. There was a man in Spring Valley who was involved in income tax fraud, was a Haitian guy. They gave him 135 years in prison. The man will die in prison. So I'm doing something that can give me 20 years, 30 years, 50 years, 100 years in prison, and nothing inside of me goes off. Nothing goes off to tell me you're jeopardizing your life. You're wasting your future. Nothing goes off. Somebody's just sleeping out there. You're just sleeping out there with everybody. You can catch AIDS. You can catch any disease that can kill you. And you don't get to see your children. You don't get to have a marriage. You don't get to have a husband. You die young. But you're just living it, and you're just having fun. Nothing ever goes off in your heart to tell you you're destroying your life. The worst thing that can ever happen to anybody is to live a life with no moral alarm, no spiritual alarm. Whatever they do, you know, there is no voice inside of them that's telling them it's wrong. The fear of God is your personal alarm. And that alarm needs to be sensitive. The sensors need to be good. It needs to be able to pick up intruders far away. In fact, they don't even have to come in. If they are even close, you know, there are alarms that we put around the perimeters of the house. Sometimes we put alarm inside, but sometimes we put the alarm, the sensors outside as soon as somebody gets closer. I pray that you would have spiritual sensors all around you. As soon as sin gets closer, as soon as lying gets closer, as soon as immorality gets closer, as soon as premarital sex gets closer, as soon as stealing gets close, whatever it is, for the alarm to go. So it doesn't even have to come in my life. If it just even come close for the alarm to go off. Oh, Daddy, we need you. We need you. Your word says, for I know the plans that I have for you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. You don't want it to destroy our lives. You don't want to destroy our tomorrow. You want to give us a great future. So I pray, Lord, for every single person in this house, every single person who wants that personal alarm system installed in their lives. Would you do it tonight, Lord? Transform me, oh God. Create in me a clean heart, oh Lord, so that I may worship you. Create in me a clean heart and purify me, create in me a clean heart so that I may worship you. Create in me a clean heart and purify me, create in me a clean heart so that I may worship you. Say, create in me a clean heart and purify me. Purify me, create in me a clean heart so that I may worship you. All of you who want the alarm installed, create. As you sing that song, God is going to install the alarm of the fear of God in your life. God is going to install that alarm in your life. It is that alarm that guards you from danger. It is that God, that alarm, that preserved your future, that preserved your tomorrow. Hallelujah. Say, create in me a clean heart and purify me. Create in me a clean heart so that I. Come on, one more time. Say, create in me a clean heart and purify me. God is about to install his alarm in your life. It's called the alarm of obedience. It's called the alarm of the fear of God. It's called the alarm of the presence of God. Say, create in me, create a clean heart. Purify me. Create in me, oh God, a pure heart, a clean heart, so I may worship. Say, cast me not
away from thy presence.
Please don't take
your spirit from me.
And restore. God, he's doing it. Say, cast me not
away from thy presence.
Please don't take
your spirit from me.
And restore
the joy of salvation
so that I
may worship.
Sorarai. May worship you. Cast me not. Cast me not. Please don't take. Please don't take. And restore. So that I. So. Hallelujah. He's putting the alarm in your life. Cast me not. Please don't take your spirit from me. And restore. Nimoroko sharaba yerebo sharaba ye. Rekedebo shara yaraba storoboko ye. Cast me not. I pray that you install your alarm all over this place. I pray that you install your spiritual alarm, your moral alarm, your ethical alarm in the life of every man, every young woman, every married person, every married woman for your glory. Cast me not. Cast me not. Please don't take your spirit from me and restore. So that I, so that I may work. Yeah, cast me not, cast me not. Please don't take. And restore. So that I, so that I. So that I, so that I may work. We're going to sing that one more time, but as we do it, if there been anybody in this place, perhaps you have not given your, Jesus Christ your life yet, or maybe you have given Jesus Christ your life, but you've walked away from him. Or maybe you're in church, but you say, man, you know, I'm not living with the fear of God over my life. I'm not living with the fear of God over my life. I need the fear of God. The last thing you ever want to happen to you as a believer is for, you know, for evil to strike, is for something to strike. It's for disaster to strike. And then later on you say, if only I knew, if only I knew, if only I knew. No, today you know, today you know. You don't have to wait for this disaster to strike and say, I wish I had changed my ways. I has wished that I had changed my behavior. I wish that I had lived differently. Today the Lord is sending that message on the fear of God so you can have a chance to change your life. He wants to install that sound system in your life, that alarm system in your life. So wherever you are in this place, as we sing that one more time, if you are here, you want to give your life to Jesus Christ for the first time, or you want to come back home, or you simply want to come back to a life of obedience to the Lord, wherever you are, come to the front as we sing that, because today is your day, and God doesn't want disaster to come in your life. He wants you to live a life of joy. He wants to live you to live a life of peace, and he wants to live you to live a life of fulfillment. Wherever you are, come forward in the name of Jesus Christ. Cast me now. Cast me now. God bless you, my brother. Please. God bless you. And restore. Wherever you are, come. Come, come to the Lord. So that I, wherever you are, young man, come. Come. Cast me now. Young woman, wherever you are, come, come. Give the Lord a round of applause as they come forward and restore. God bless you, my brother. God bless you, my sister. God, come, cast me now. Please don't take. And restore. So that I may create in me a clean heart, oh God. Create a clean heart and purify me. Purify me. Create in me a clean heart so that I Cast me not.
Please don't take your spirit from me.
And restore,
restore the joy of salvation.
So that I may worship. Say, cast me not away, O Lord.
Please don't take your spirit from me.
And restore.
Everybody, just lift up your hand, including those who've come to the front. Say, Lord Jesus, thank you for talking to me today. Once again, Lord, I give you my life. I commit my life to you. I want to live for you. Install your alarm system in my life. Install the fear of the Lord in my life. And help me, Lord, to catch and throw out every spiritual intruder in the name of Jesus Christ. I want to live for you and you alone. Fill me and seal me with your Holy Spirit. Forgive me of my sins, Lord, and write my name in the book of life, never to be erased again. Thank you for the close communion and relationship that I have with you. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.